everybody is awake again. Yeah. That's what we want for this session, because what we looked at is how FTIR works, how to look at spectras, what we can do with it. So now let's look at where we want to apply microscopy, where we want to apply a regular bench when it comes to a microplastic sample in general. So, I mean, to this entire audience, I don't even need to go over this slide, I think. We all know what we are looking for. We are looking for some of these things. And what we really want to understand here is the range of samples that you can have, all the way from like 5 millimeters down to a micron, or even below micron, right? And how to go about it. So, how we approach, how we have learned to approach this so far, and this may change, I mean, over the next 1 or 2 or 3 years as we get to do a better job and as we get to learn more, is so far what we always recommend is if you have samples from 5 to like 0.5 or maybe a millimeter or so, pick it up, put it right on your bulk ATR, run it. It's quick, easy, it doesn't take more than 20 seconds to get a spectrum, get a match, and be done, right? So instead of just moving right to a slide, just move it right onto your ATR, be done with it. So that's easy. But then comes the smaller particles where you are not able to move it around or anything like that. It's on a certain type of filter. It came, it is processed in a certain way. Those are the ones basically closer to like 250 or 100 micron down to 10 micron or so. You can easily analyze with IR, or when I say easily analyze with IR, is you can use different approaches and then easily analyze with FTIR and find an identification. But what happens when it goes below 10 microns to a micron or even to a submicron level? That's where we will also recommend it is better to go with Roma. It's really, so that's where I think earlier also this question had come up, like that Raman tends to be good for like really low size as well. So yes, you can use Raman for all the other regions, but the ones below 10, Raman's really good. But the other way we overcome the 10 micron challenge is by using micro ATRs. So remember I also told you like why 10 micron is kind of the borderline that we define between IR. Or like the limitation for IR, think about the range you're working on. Think about the IR light range, right? So earlier we defined the range closer to like 2.5 to 15 microns. So 10 micron comes right in the center of it. So what happens is, as you go below 10 micron, can the samples work? Yes, you have, if you have an absolutely good sample, it will work. We have done small red blood cells down to like 5 microns. We have done that in transmission. You prepare the sample well, it will work. But what happens is, most of the times you're going to see some, it limits some artifacts because it's diffraction limited, right? Your sample is 10 micron, or your sample is 5 micron, you're hitting it with a beam that may be even bigger or broader, or you may be, you can hit it with smaller amount of light, but then it will be all, your beam that comes back can get distorted because of the diffraction limits. So that's why, the only way, or the one of the easiest way to overcome the 10 micron diffraction limit physics for any kind of particle is to use micro ATR. And this is not just like an instrumentation limitation or anything like that. This is more a limit that physics has put on it. You are working in the same range as the absorption peaks you're looking for. So you are diffraction limited in that range, right? So, and I will talk about how using a micro ATR you can actually overcome it, and you can, how low you can really go with the micro ATR as well. This is just a rule of thumb that we can follow through. So this is what we will do tomorrow as well, because there are so many different size particles that Hannah and Keenan have helped us extract last time. We will use all of those because there's like a really wide range of sizes that you have. So we will do all the big and the small ones tomorrow. But if you have a standard big sample, we will run a quick measurement right up on the crystal. So you put the sample up there, measure, done. folks who may sometimes do get like small particles, and they it's not really a very common for them to look at microparticles below like 500 microns or so. They use this small accessory. This is made by your partner company that's called Zytec. And what this is it's like a very low end viewing ATR or a microscope. Low end, you can see some, okay, I have a small 200 micron particle, I can put it in there, I can get a quick data on my instrument. So the nice thing is it fits into the smaller instrument, so that's why folks sometimes use that. So what I want to show you is where you can apply this and where we have seen this applied. So this is a collaborative work that was done at a Center for Coastal Studies. And what we are looking at here is very simple polyethylene sample, just which was extracted out from gray seal scat samples, cleaned up, put it on the ATR, you get a spectra, you're done. But look at this sample by itself. You can easily define this as polyethylene. You see how we are defining this as kaolin, or clay, or something that has some kaolin mixed in. How do you even define this is because you can look in the 3700 region as well. Like I said, having a very broad range of spectrum to look at really helps in that region. If you had just looked in this region, with your data, it will be very difficult for you to determine whether this is just polyethylene, polyethylene mixed with kaolin, polyethylene mixed with calcium carbonate, or anything else, or talc. So if you look at the polymer industry right now, almost every bit of polymer, they will add some inorganics to it. So, and the reason they add to it is because it gives a lot of stability, it gives a lot of properties that makes it way more durable. And being able to characterize those can be important. So that's why using a full range source is way easier on interpretation's sake than just looking at a very, very small region by itself. So where else, or what else can we do, right? So these are the big samples, there's an example with it. So now let's think about microscopy. So where do you want to apply microscopy? Is if it's a small sample, microscopic sample that you cannot analyze with bench alone, right? That's where you want to use it. So you have a small particle and you just want to figure out what this is in comparison to what's around it. That's what microscopy really does. But you can do a lot of fun stuff with it. You can look at a cross section of a polymer, you can map and do a lot of different types of measurements. And that's what we want to learn during this next maybe like 30 minutes is what do we really do with IR microscopy? The process is very simple. You look at your sample, decide where you want to analyze. You want this black area or you want the middle area or so. So if I want to analyze this particular middle area, I'll define that as my area of interest and that's where I'll set my aperture at. So I brought in a very big term called aperture. So aperturing is important. So basically what you're trying to do is you're closing down the beam of light so that it hits just your sample and nothing around it. Or it just hits that one line and you're not trying to get data from around it. So that's very, very important when it comes to microscopy, what aperture you're using. Because as we go further into mapping, that would become really, really important what you're setting it up.
So that's different from focus, or is that basically focus is what you're talking about?
No, so aperture is actually two metal blades. Like if we just simplify it, it just closes it down.
Okay.
So if you have a big beam, that is, so IR beams, when it is in the microscope as well, it will be closer to like 200 microns. It's completely focused, 200 micron beam. But if your particle or the region of interest is only 20 microns, you cut the beam down so it just doesn't have the vision to look anywhere else. It just looks at that region where it is hitting. So, and with the instrument, what you can do is actually, you can see while you're measuring. So you can be sure that you view it and you measure it. So you don't have to put another mirror in or anything like that. You view it, you set the aperture, and the visible aperture is visible to you. So you can see that. that is a visible light, so you can see it. So, and then you get a spectrum or you collect a map. So basically defining, there are three different modes you can do in a measurement. So one is the most common one, you will see the point and shoot. So point and shoot is you have a fiber point, get the data done. It's good for particles, inclusions, and other things. The second thing that is really good and that will get a lot of application is what we call mapping. So the mapping is where you are looking at a certain region and you just want to analyze a cross-section of it. So what you're trying to do is you get a visible, you get a chemical. So it's just a continuous measurement, so not just one measurement at one slide, but you just keep going on and on and on, and you create a chemical map with it. Then comes imaging. So imaging is what is done on a larger area. So it's mapping. You may always want to think about smaller areas. When you think about imaging, it's like usually a couple of millimeters or a centimeter and so forth. So that's a large area. Mapping is technically what you would call a imaging per se. This we saw earlier as well. The same four modes are applicable to IR microscopy as well. And the transmission, reflectance, and diffuse and specular reflectance. So now what we want to do is look at each of them in detail and how this applies to microscopy, which ones to apply where, and let's look at a microplastic sample for each example for each of them. So if you think about transmission, reflectance, or ATR, all that can be done with all the different instruments that we offer. The one that you're going to use is called the IN10. This is what we have in the lab. There's two of these. This is capable of doing transmission, reflectance, micro ATR, as well as the one that's in the lab has what we call the array detector in it. So you can look at very large areas as well if you want to. You can look at half of a filter, full of the filter, or a 13 millimeter entire filter by itself in one shot. So depending on what your end goal is, you have all the options in the IN10 instrumentation by itself. For some folks who already know that, no, I'm going to isolate my samples from maybe marine organisms, maybe from some sources where I need to individually isolate it, they may go this way. I know that's what you guys do. And there's a lot of other labs that do the same is because you're individually isolating it from a little shrimp or a little crab or organisms or fishes, you have individual fibers isolated, right? What you really want to do is have a nice simple data. So you will just do point and shoot with some instrument just like this, as well as you can do that with our continuum microscope. The continuum can do all the three modes, but as well as it can do a lot of really good optical imaging, optical views. So if somebody also wants to look at a fluorescence along with the IR at the same point, they actually use the continuum. So just to differentiate out all the three different instruments out there. So the continuum is capable of doing fluorescence as well. So let's look at the cross-section of the instrument that we are going to work with. So the reason I showed the whole schematics in the morning is if you look at the IN10, and even if we take the cover off, you cannot see the source or anything like that because it's all inside this desiccated module. Why it is inside the desiccated module is, again, this morning we talked about there can be CO2 and moisture as interference. So, but we want to avoid as much as possible. So the source and the interferometer sits inside this box. If the beam comes out, then goes through a couple of mirrors. In transmission mode, it comes down, goes up, and reaches either these two detector or the third detector that's in the back. If it is in the reflectance mode, it would just go up and come from the top, hit the sample that is going to be right up here on the stage, and then go back to the detectors. So this is the same cutout for the instrument that you have here. Three different detectors, the DTGS and the two MCTs. The DTGS is a very powerful detector in there, even though it is for larger sample sizes, like 50 microns and above. The reason is you can look at a regions down to 400 wave numbers with the DTGS by itself. So let's look at transmission in general, how to apply transmission and where, what type of data we can get out from transmission. So transmission is actually the one of the best one because it's going to give you best spectral quality, but making a transmission sample for microscopy can be really challenging. There's a couple of different tools and we will learn to use it in the lab. So like if you have fibers and you want to really differentiate out between rayon and cellulose, because these are very, very similar spectrums, something like a transmission can be very, very helpful. And how to prepare samples for that, we'll learn that in the lab as well. So we will use what we call a compression cell, and we will learn how to press your sample down so it's nice and flat and analyze it. If it becomes too thick, it will not work because then you don't have enough light to go through. So here's more details on how we will do this. So you can put samples right up there on like in between two windows, or you can put it between like a compression cell and press it down really, or compress it down really hard and prepare your sample. Let's look at an example. So this, here's an example of basically three different particles that is picked out and put on like a small compression cell, and you can see two of them are polymers, one is a chitin. So it's a transmission measurement, but you get a pretty good quality spectrum. And the other part is if you want to save these particles for other uses and so forth, it's a nice way to do that as well, to use compression cells. So the next type of analysis we should talk about is reflectance. So you will see that reflectance is going to be one of the most common type of analysis that you will see in your industry. And the reason is almost very little sample prep. You can just measure right up on the surface, or you can take the sample and put it or flatten it out on a reflective surface, like a gold slide. And we will do that also in the lab. So we will take some of your samples from last time, we'll put it on a gold slide. That would be your, I think we still have some fish extract samples where we saw some fibers. We will use those. We'll take a little bit of it, put it on a gold slide, make a nice roll out of it, and then we'll try to analyze it and see what we can get with those, and we will map it out as well. So there is not really a big deal of sample prep you really need to do with the reflectance per se. So that's why, and if you have filters and other things, it's still going to be very useful. But the problem is right here. So with reflectance, it has its advantage, but the problem is you start to see what we call Rasfallen peaks, or what we it is like, and this is not because there is a different way you can analyze. It's just because we haven't prepped the sample. So what is going on is you're trying to compare it to a standard that would be something like a gold mirror or so. And then you hit a sample which is not highly reflective. You can get a nice reflective spectrum, or you can have a not so nice reflective spectrum because of the mismatch between the reflectance properties. And this type of issues or artifacts that you would see, can you correct for it? Yes. Is the corrections always perfect? No, because you're applying an external algorithm all the time. So always keep this in mind, that do you want a data that is really clean, pure, not very manipulated or so forth, or you want to look at data that's like where you have done a lot of corrections and improvements to get the data out, right? So reflectance, you are going to face a lot of Rasfallen peaks, and you can, and we will see that also tomorrow, but no sample prep, so it really helps. So the other way, also, if we had rolled the sample on the gold slide, then we can look at more reflectance data, but you see it right from the surface, as well as what we call the reflectance data. These data are also defined or are limited by the thickness of how thick your samples are on the surface of the gold. So let's look at some examples as well. So this is one of the nicely done ones, because look at the thickness at which the sample is cut at 5 microns, right? So what the sample is, what we should talk about. So this was done collaboration with Wayne State University. So what they did is they had mussels, zebra mussels, and they fed them with microbeads, or 5-micron microbeads, and these organisms took it into their muscles. So basically the microbeads actually went into the muscle tissue by itself. So, and then this was cast into gelatin, and then they made a microtome sections of these. So the sample, what we are looking at here, so this is the visual view, this is the chemistry of it. So then what we are looking at here, these little spots are the distribution of polyethylene microbeads on the muscle tissue. How do we know that? Is because each of this can be correlated. So the blue region is correlated to the tissue, basically. And the little dots right now is correlated to the polyethylene. So we can correlate it then again to the library spectra and figure it out what is in there. So can this be applied to every bit of sample? It's difficult. It's very challenging. But if you can microtome your samples, I mean, it can give you really good transmission sample. It can transmission spectra, as well as it can give you great reflection spectrum as well. So this was a really fun study to do. So if you look at the 5-micron beads are also resolved. So like I said in the beginning, we call 10 as our cutoff. Can we resolve 5? Yes, you can. It depends where your particles are distributed, how you are measuring it. So this one, it is done with the array detector that we will learn tomorrow to use. So this is a collection of almost 23,000 spectrums in general. So imagine how close this is actually measured. So this is measured at a spatial resolution, so there is every 2-micron there is a spectrum in that region. So that's why we are able to resolve it out. And on top of that, these two spectra are well differentiated, so it is easy to define and separate it out just by looking at the correlations.
So that total field there is what, like 50 microns or something like that?
Yeah, so this actually the total area, I think like closer to maybe 200 microns by 400 microns.
Okay.
Yeah. It's a very small area actually. But it's a very close analysis. So basically the beam has gone through it almost every 2 microns. So we looked at transmission that can be applied to microplastic. You just have to define your samples correctly. You can apply reflectance to microplastics, and again, you can map it out. And you can also do mapping for your filters just with what we looked at, the reflectance. And we will look at some more data later in the afternoon with the reflectance mapping as well. But you can get really good quality spectra also with ATR. So like I said, the ATR spectrum quality can be absolutely as good as the transmission spectrum. And provided your sample is right at the top. So basically, if your sample is exposed, you can analyze it with ATR, because ATR is again a surface technique. We're looking at the surface by itself. And the second caveat here is, are you okay in making a contact with your sample? A lot of folks, when they send a sample, they will be like, no, we just want you to analyze it as is. So that's the point we go with the reflectance, because we cannot make the individual contact with the sample. But if somebody says, yeah, here I have 25 fibers, I'll tell you a story of the 25 fibers this afternoon. Each of them actually was analyzed in ATR. And we also looked at it in transmission and for a certain purpose, and to compare how good the quality of data is as well. So can you look at fibers? Can you look at materials in transmission? Absolutely you can. And this, like I said, gives you an advantage to look at even fibers that can be just hardly 2 microns thick. So you have a fiber that's 2 microns thick, you really want to, either you have to compress it, make it flattened out, or you can do it with a micro ATR. Why you can do it with a micro ATR is, let me show you. So remember I said only one thing from the from the ATR slide deck you want to remember is the germanium's refractive index. Did anybody remember?
Four.
Good, good, good. Everybody was listening. Awesome. So if you have a refractive index of 4, so what you are doing is your beam is going through this high refractive index material, right? So it's not air through which it is going through. Now it is going through a high refractive index material. So what happens is you can set your aperture for 100 micron, but just because the HER crystal is in the beam path or the germanium crystal is in the beam path, when the light goes through, it just gets automatically focused down to 25 microns. Hmm. So you can set an aperture for 20 microns and basically get a 5 micron particle separated out or analyzed or just focused in on. You can set it for 10 and get a 2.5 done. So that's how we overcome the rule of physics for diffraction limits in general, I would say in general. So, and when I do this slide, usually there's one question that follows up. So how low have you gone, or how low can you measure? The lowest I have done personally is closer to like 1.5 to 2 microns. So 1.5, yes, you can do it, and it can be a very, very nice spectrum, but you have to collect longer. Remember, you're bringing your beam down really, really small. That means the amount of light that is hitting your sample is really small. So that means when it comes back up, you have to collect your data for quite some time. But if you collect it, you get a beautiful spectrum out from 2 microns as well.
Well, what does that mean? That means an hour? That means...
No. So in general, like tomorrow when we run the samples, we will run mostly like 64 or 128 scans, which would be hardly like 20 seconds. So this would be more like 500 scans or 1,000 scans. So that would be like a minute and a half. In IR terms, when we say long, it's like 2 minutes. But when you do
internet maps, generation, there you go.
When we do maps, it's like we talk, like depending on how much resolution you really want to go, how well you want to resolve those little thing differences, you can do maps for hours or you can do a quick map in minutes. So it depends.
Is this similar to the AFM technique people are using to get down into the nanoscale with IR?
Not exactly.
Okay.
No. With the AFM technique, I mean, I'm not an AFM expert, but with the AFM technique, because you are actually taking the advantage of the AFM tip by itself to bring the beam in.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I see.
For ETR or migrator, do you have to use aperture?
Yes. Well, you have to in the higher benches, and if you want to keep things consistent. So when it comes to the lower benches or instrument, you can just put the 100 micron aperture in, and then that means all the ATR spectrums you're measuring will be at a 25 micron resolution. If you don't use it in like IM5, where you have a manual aperture in, it's basically going to be, so it's a 250 view, so it's going to be closer divided by 4. So every time, that's the area that's going to go through. So closer to like 60 to 70 microns, every sample it will go through. So both are perfectly fine. It's just to keep the consistency. Okay, so that's, any other questions on micro ATR and how we overcome the diffraction limits? So this is a diffraction, I mean, this is a property of physics. So basically, if somebody asks you a question, can your instrument or do you have the capability to do 2 microns? I usually will say we're limited at 10 microns, but then I go with the second sentence that yes, you can push the limit, but you have to push it in a slightly different way for most general samples. But there will be samples that you will come across, like the example I mentioned of silicone, right? It's a very strong IR active material, and even though you will get some diffraction issues with those, when you look at it, I mean, the spectral quality is so good that the diffraction limit may look, or the artifacts that it's creating is going to look very minimum. So you may see a 5 micron sample very nicely in a reflectance measurements, or just like what we looked at the polyethylene in that muscle samples, which just look fine. So here's some example of analysis of microbeads. These are just isolated microbeads from some personal care products. So these are all run with micro ATR, so basically run in different range. effectiveness of micro ATR on a simple point and shoot measurement instrumentation. So sometimes we get asked, okay, so micro ATR, so when it makes one contact, right, can we do mapping with it? Or can I have like 100 particles in there? Can I go one to next to next to next to all the particles and do the measurements? Yes, you can, but not with most of your particles. Because what will happen is you make one contact. Sometimes what will happen is your particle will stick to the crystal or it will leave a residue on the crystal, so you will have to clean it. So that's the biggest issue that will come with the micro ATR. But then folks want to do mapping with the ATR, and so for that is what we use, what we call a imaging ATR. Again, is imaging ATR mainly for most of your analysis? Probably not. Because where this will come in really handy is if you have a piece of polymer which is like 500 microns and you go and you want to really get a good quality spectrum from point A to point B across that 500 micron and you want to see the distribution of that and so forth, that would be great. So a lot of folks will put cross sections and other things to analyze on this. I have this in the lab so you can also see it. If we get time, we can work with it as well. But think about your experiments in the meanwhile. Like if there is an experiment that you want to do where you want to maybe characterize a small piece that you may have found in the gut of an animal and you just want a complete map of that little piece, which may be like smaller than 500 micron, this can be the right thing to do. This will give you a very good distribution of that particular particle. So here's an example of basically looking at a laminate layer. So it's just a 100 micron sample layer, but you see how well, so if you had a laminate layer and you want to differentiate like polypropylene, EVOH, and all the different things that's in there, this is the way to go. Like the question that came up this morning is like, if can two different instruments give two different data? Yes, this is the type of sample that can give that. Because if I analyze this end of it and one of your colleagues analyze this end of it, one person may say the sample is polypropylene, other person will say that's polyethylene, right? Mm. So that can also happen. So that will be another sample you definitely want to look for a distribution in there. But most of you here, or at least some of you here, do want to do is a lot of automation. So you can do automation just with mapping. Yes, you will have data from every point that you have your mapping out. Or you can do what we call a particle wizard. Or here, what you're trying to do is you can have a large area and you're just going to pick and choose your particles. The software will do this automatically for you, so it just makes things way easier. But you can do this in reflectance or transmittance mode. If your samples are transmitted enough, you can do that. So we will do that again in the lab today as well. So this is an example of a sample that was done with Dr. Gamino and Martinez group from University of Washington. So what they had done is they had sent us samples basically, and this is a small bit of the sample spread on a gold slide, and then the particle size wizard just goes and automatically picks up all the particles that you can see up here, and this is, it is picking up based on the visual. So anything it is seeing, it's going to pick up. It's not making a differentiation, it's just a based on the contrast, it picks up the particles, it will generate spectra for all of these. And then once you have all the particles picked up, you can say, okay, what type, it will automatically do a identification for you, and it will tell you, okay, you have polyester, for the rest of it maybe just normal material. So again, we will do this in lab, but it is also important to understand that it's very easy if your samples are perfectly prepped, if your samples are on a perfect filter, if your samples are really clean. This will work perfectly well. If not, you will face challenges. The other part, we will do this also in the lab, is because there will be two groups in each session, is we'll have different libraries set for two groups. I'm just telling you the little hints right now what's going to happen. And if you have libraries that are just of the same quality as the spectra that you have here, you may be better off getting a good match because this is a reflectance spectra. get actually a better matches and better differentiation out. If you take this data and try to use it against a transmission, actually I wanted to keep it as a secret for tomorrow. One of you don't have that in one of the papers. So if you just match it up to transmission libraries, it's not going to be of that great of a quality, right? So the correlations are not going to be good. So you are not going to see really a good quality hit. So this works great if you put a little bit of effort in up front. Then you can make this type of automation work really well for you. So in short, what I have learned so far doing the microplastics work as well as running it in our microscopy is a couple of key considerations. So the reason we went over all these different types of analysis, what the challenges are in each of the analysis is because you can then decide based on what you want to do, what type of sample prep should be. Your sample prep, as long as it's free of surface contamination, great. That's really the key because you are looking at the surface techniques, right? So IR and Raman are surface technique to a big extent. So IR typically is surface because you don't do any confocal on IR at all. The second one can be very challenging, sample overloading. So if you have a sample, a particle on top of a particle, whatever is on the top is what it's going to see. So when you are taking your samples for IR, and I think it's exactly the same for Raman, is keep nicely diluted or separated particles on your filters, on the slide, wherever you're looking to analyze. Don't overcrowd them because what's on the top is getting the more preference. The choice of filters and slides or sieves, and we will talk this really in depth in the afternoon as well. There's a lot of options that are there, a lot of options that a lot of labs are using, but we are still in the beginning phase to say, yep, this is the perfect one for you, this is the perfect one for you. I think by end of this particular study, because a lot of groups will be doing it, and there will be, everybody will come to a common decision that, okay, these type of samples work great with this type of filters, if you look at it, if you have done it well, and so forth. So even as us are looking forward to this, the completion of the study to see where actually, what works the best for most people, rather than just look at literature and see, go with one or the other, which may be very expensive. So a lot of times we talk about gold, and a lot of labs feedback we get is also, it's too pricey. So I guess by end of this study, we should know way, way better from a combination of everybody's ideas and ideas. Then you have to always decide what particles, maps, and which type of analysis methods you really want to use. So have this in mind even before you start the sample prep. That's the key here. If you really want to do a map, have the perfectly cleaned up sample. I can tell you that. Otherwise, you just will get so much data that you will end up like, you're trying to find that one good data in a big haystack. So that gets more troublesome. So it's really easy, like, oh, I want to do a map, have a nice cleanest prep ever. Okay, that's all I had for now. Questions?
We heard that there's sometimes an issue differentiating flat fibers versus blue fibers with FTIR. How do we go about fixing that?
So black fibers versus blue fibers. So if this is based on color, so that's a key thing here. When you think about fibers, right? Fibers will always have is of a cylindrical shape. So you cannot get exactly the same kind of reflectance back from if it's a dyed fiber or if it is an undyed fiber. One of the best ways to analyze fibers that I have figured out is use the compression cell, because if you pick it up, put it in, compress it, you get a perfect data. Or if the fiber is sitting flat, so that's the other part that's going to happen, is in a lot of filters, the fibers stand up or will be in a tilted way that the beam cannot even hit it in a proper orientation. In those instances, you want to go with the micro ATR. But when you compare them, the differences could be the differences in dye, if it's the same material, right? If your polyethylene fiber dyed blue or polyethylene fiber that is black, but But when it comes to black, there's a lot of carbon-filled fibers too. So that's the one point, like you get, okay, if there's a carbon-filled fiber or you doubt it could be a carbon-filled fiber, Raman will be very, very beneficial because Raman sees carbon backbone really good. So you can identify that additive just by looking at the same fiber in Raman as well. So it's, and but when you look at Raman, again, think about the laser that you're using and everything, so you just don't burn the samples as well. So, but dyes can cause a big difference in the spectral effect that you're looking at. So that's why I know there's a lot of groups that are working really hard to create libraries for these dyed particles, colored fibers. I guess your group is also involved in that. There's other groups that is involved in that. I mean, your samples are not simple. That's what I have learned so far. It's like, everybody says we have microplastic samples, but every time it comes, it's a totally different set of samples or totally different way to look at it.